started in you, yeah, he's gonna finish. He put that hunger in your heart. Hunger in your heart. Put that fire in your soul.
For the can't go back, sing it for the broken past, sing it for the just found out life is now upside down.
If you're looking for hope tonight, raise your hand. If you feel alone and don't understand, if you're finding the fight in your life, then stand. We're gonna
we'll together we are bolder, braver, stronger.
Take our breath away. Tragedy can leave a wake. A broken heart won't ever beat the same. And pain can stop us in our tracks. Losing what we can't get back. Shaking the foundations of our faith. No matter what's in my way. No matter the battles I face.
Many a dream has died. Like a tree planted by the water, we never will run dry. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire. Just to know you and to make you known, we lift your name on high. Shine like the sun, make darkness run and hide.
world, we're reaching out to show them who you are. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire, just to
I'm lifting up my heart again, cause even when I can't see the plan, I know your love is closing in on me. You hold the whole world in your hands till you feel the pain, you understand. And just to all I'm standing in, no, no, it's a blessing I can't see, yeah. It's a blessing I can't see, yeah. You're not working, always, even when it won't stop hurting. Cause I know every setback was a setup for something greater that you had in store. All along, you've seen beyond the storm. So when I struggle, I will trust you. I trust you with everything. I trust you with everything, oh God. I'm lifting up my heart again, cause even when I can't see it bad, I know your love is closing in on me. You hold the whole world in your hands till you feel the pain, you understand. Ain't just a wall I'm standing in, no, no. It's a blessing I can't see.
that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great? Such boundless grace. The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of kings calls me his own. Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain.
Declare the grave has We praise you, Father. We thank you, God, for the truth of that song, that you are our living hope. Father, you died on that cross and you were placed in that borrowed tomb, but you're not in there. For you rose 3 days later and you are alive and well. You are a powerful and mighty, loving, giving Father, our God, our Savior. And we come before you today, God, to celebrate a life lived well. We come together, Father, today to honor George and just show this family how much we love them and how much we support them in this time. So we praise you, God, for what you're going to do in this place today. Thank you that you are our living hope. You are George's living hope, and that has been fully revealed to him. And we praise you for that. For we ask this in your name. Amen. Amen. At this time, I'm going to invite Mark Douglas, family friend and pastor in our community here, as he comes to share with us.
I could not consider it a greater privilege than to be standing here on behalf of this family and for my friend, George Conn. George was one of those guys that if you were a friend to him, he was a friend to you, you knew it was a forever friendship. No matter where you went, no matter what happened, no matter how many days, months, years went by, you knew that he was going to continue to be a friend to you. And I appreciated that so much about him. On November 19th, George Russell Conn III finished his earthly race of 70 years and was called to his home in heaven. George was preceded in death by his parents, George and Jackie Conn. He is survived by his loving wife, Annette, of 48 years, his daughters, Julie Conn of Micanopy, and Katie and husband Adam Chesser of Eustis, and his granddaughter, Finley. Katie and Adam. He is also survived by his brother, Charlie, wife Debbie, Bob, wife Maura, Alan, and wife Vonnie, all of Eustis, 15 nieces and nephews, and 15 plus great nieces and great nephews who all love their Uncle George. George was born on October 20th, 1951, grew up in Fort Lauderdale. He was involved in judo, switched to karate. He was one test away from being a black belt. He graduated from Strannan High School in 1969. He earned his civil engineering degree from Broward Community College in 1972. He also acquired his real estate license, but was too young to utilize it at the time. In 1973, he married his high school sweetheart, Annette, and bought another love, a brand new bright orange Camaro, which he kept and continued to tinker on his whole life. He moved with his parents and brothers to Eustis, Florida in 1973 and began his own family and career. George worked first running plaster crews for his dad's stucco plastering business in Fort Lauderdale. Then after moving to Lake County, he worked at Florida Power and Light in Sanford for 44 years, recently retiring in 2020. He also was a general contractor and built several homes in the Central Florida area. He loved being outside and was an avid outdoorsman. He was a skilled hunter, enjoying archery, gun, and dog hunting for deer and turkey. He also enjoyed fishing and bow hunting. He was a race fan, watching everything from NASCAR to truck racing. He also got to experience being a one-man pit crew for his friend racing at the Volusia County Speedway. In his younger days, he spent a lot of his time on the water with his family and his friends, spearfishing, skin diving, water skiing, and he went on to become a certified scuba diver. He served his Lord by being very involved in the churches he attended through his life. From being a deacon at Cassia Baptist, in the choir at Bay Street Baptist, and to currently singing in the choir and volunteering with Annette every Sunday at Preschool Children's Church here at Life Point. He was always ready to help at various church functions, including their yearly trunk or treat, night to shine, and vacation Bible schools. He faithfully gave and supported Ethnos 360, formerly New Tribes Missions, mission work, and many missionaries through his life. He was a 4-H dad, volunteer while his daughters were active members, helping through the year with our club meetings, projects, and summer camps. He continued to support Annette's 4-H club all through the years up to his passing, helping many generations of 4-Hers. He walked his life with the Lord and was a faithful servant. He was the rock to his family and extended family, always sought out for his wisdom and sound, level-headed advice. He had a kind heart and was soft-spoken, but was never afraid to stand up for his beliefs and what was right. He made his world and community a better place and will dearly be missed by all who were blessed to know him. He leaves a wonderful legacy of walking with God, being dedicated to his family, and always there to help a friend. We will miss our friend George Conn, but praise God he's not lost. We know where he is. We'll see him again.
I want to thank you guys for coming. And Annette, you need to look around because there's a few people here. And it's because George was incredibly loved and you're incredibly loved. You know, one of the things that you're going to find if you're a stranger to Life Point or even a stranger to the Lord, we don't do dirges for believers because we believe that they are alive and well, and George is doing fine. And you know what? He's going to allow us to do fine, too. There's a scripture that I want to read, but first, I got to tell you, George will be missed here because we've been in a panic for the last couple of weeks going, who are we going to get to do that? Because George did everything. You know, I mean, it's like, we can always call George, and so Life Point guys, you're going to have to step up because one person can't do it anymore because we don't have that one person that can do everything. And so, but we love George and Annette, and I'll tell you, the impact that you guys have made has been amazing. You know, we grieve, but we grieve in a little bit different way. And so, probably my favorite passage of Scripture when it comes to times like this is in 1 Thessalonians. Because it says, dear brothers and sisters, I don't want you to grieve like you have no hope. He didn't tell us not to grieve. But if we're going to grieve, we're going to grieve with hope. Because it's a whole different thing to grieve without hope and grieve with hope. And so he says, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and we do, even so God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. And then it says, comfort one another with these words. And what's interesting, everybody stops there, but I'd like to go a little farther because a few verses later in the next chapter, it says, God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. And then he says again, therefore comfort one another with these words. And in these few verses, in these just separating each other, he keeps coming back to comfort. And the question is, How can death be comforting? How can you be comforted in death? Well, we can be comforted in death because there's a promise for us that we're going to live and be with him forever. One of the things that we know about George is he's not dead. He is fully alive, and he is with the Lord. And that's a promise that God has given us. And because of that, we're going to see him again, and we know that it's going to be okay because God's going to make it okay. And that we know you're going to be okay. Girls, we know you're going to be okay. Why? Because God's going to make it okay. He's going to make it that way because that's who he is. He loves you with an everlasting love, and you are surrounded with people who love you with an amazing love. And God's going to make it all right. How does that look like? What does that look like? We don't know, but we trust because he promised it. And because God makes those promises, we can be confident in what he's promised us. And we can rest in that. And our hope is resting in him and the promises that he's given us so that we can have life.
Y'all, as it has already been expressed, George was a friend to everybody. And I have had the privilege of being here at Life Point Church or First Baptist Eustis for a long time. And I've had many folks come through our doors that have served in many capacities in many different ways. But there is no one like George. As it was said, there were days I didn't even have to call the man. He would just show up knowing I needed the help, and he was there. I wore the camo today in honor of him, and then I also wore the Crocs because there wasn't anywhere George didn't go without his Crocs. He always had them on. And so we never had the privilege of hunting together, but we always shared the pictures off of our cameras and the stories. And he shared with me the pictures of what he had recently seen on his cameras as he was headed up to Georgia. We shared a lot of love for a lot of the same things, but I will say that I will miss my friend so very much, as you will as well. And as Dan said, we know where he is. There's no doubt there. But he will truly be missed. And what I'd like to do in honor of him is to share a song together as a congregation. A song we all know, but it's got a little bit of a twist in it, and this is a song, Amazing Grace. And so I would encourage you can remain seated, but let's sing it together. But there's a portion, though, to this song that changes and begins to sing the words, my chains are gone, I've been set free. And so as we sing this song, we'll share in this time together, and then we've got one other thing that we're going to do before Pastor JP comes to share with us. But let's sing together. My Savior has ransomed me.
has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior.
Please draw your attention to the screen and let's see this life lived well from, my gosh, wait till you see some of these pictures, how awesome they are. Let's watch it together.
Are you tired and troubled, weighed down by a heavy load, praying for change, searching for faith, waiting on a miracle? Are you drowning in questions, can't believe where the road has led? There's one who knows the heavy you hold, and he says, come to me. Oh,
that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt. Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling. Calm the sea would call out through the rain and calm the storm in me. Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who.
Don't you love those pictures? And if you knew George, you knew hunting stories, so I put my camo on as well in honor of Mr. George Conn. This afternoon, I'd like to welcome you on behalf of the family and on behalf of Life Point Church to this service as we celebrate a life lived incredibly well. My name's J.P. Jonathan Pearson. It's my privilege to serve as lead pastor. Mark, I'm like you. I can't think of a bigger honor and privilege than to talk about this man who made such an impact. And I would share again, family, just look around. Look at the amazing impact of the life of Mr. George Conn. But as Dan said, we are not here to do anything short of celebrate a life lived well and his homegoing. Because of Jesus Christ and that alone, we know and we believe that nothing can separate us from his love. And actually, we can know right now, as Dan said, that Mr. George is in God's presence right now as we speak, and he is more alive than he has ever been. And that's hard to believe, because he lived well. Today, I want you to know that while there will be many tears shed, some laughter, there's going to be all types of emotions. Today, we can come to a service like this with joy. It may seem strange, but if you knew George, you know that there was something more to that gentle kindness that really epitomized who he is. Joy. Joy is not happiness. Joy is something so much greater, much more powerful. And it only comes from the presence of Jesus Christ in our lives. That joy is a result of peace that surpasses all understanding. And that is what we have today And that's why we can come to this moment with hope, because we know that George Conn loved Jesus with all of his heart. And he lived that for every single one of us, not just to see or hear, but to feel with everything that he did. So today, he is more alive than ever, and his struggle with this world is over, and it's wrapped up in victory. Amen? So we've not come to say goodbye to Mr. George, but to say until we see you again, sweet friend, in heaven. I want to share Romans 8, 38 and 39 with you. It says this, "For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Mr. George was a kind and generous man who was willing to help and serve anyone. And Pedro's right. You didn't have to call George Conn. He would already be here because he just knew you were going to need help. Such a powerful example of what a true servant is. And he's a man of strength and courage as well, as has already been shared, but was so humble. He lived that, and it just punctuated what a good and gracious man he is. He wasn't perfect. None of us are. But he was just a good, good man. And I'm here to tell you today that's what makes him a great man. Because he lived what he loved about Jesus for all of us. He loved Jesus, he loved his family, and he loved his church. And did we mention hunting? He was an outdoorsman for sure. And Pedro, I'm like you, man. Every time I saw Mr. George, it was either talking about what we were hunting or what we were about to go hunting. So it was just, you could always count on that. A few things here on display. I want to share a few of these with you because they're just so incredible. The duck, this mallard here, was taken on a hunt with Bob in Arkansas. And this is a truly special duck because it has three curls. Just a beautiful example of the outdoors, and I love that. The fish was caught on Lake Seminole, where the Alabama, Georgia, and Florida state lines all joined together. George, Bob, and Jimmy would fish there for at least a week every year. And that is the biggest crappie George ever caught. And I know some of y'all are saying, wait a second, Pastor, don't say that. It's a speckled perch for some of y'all, but for us Southerners, that's a crappie. The turkey, which he hunted during spring gobbler season, it was a turkey he took on an archery hunt. And the first one, and he bagged one with a 12-inch beard. That's impressive. And then this metal calendar is awesome because it really depicts his love for old cars and trucks. You would always see George and Annette at the old car shows. And he started to feel like he was beginning to run out of time with the old cars. So back in June, he felt like he wanted to build his own dream truck. So in June, they began the process of having a 1956 Chevy truck to be built and restored for George. And then the deer. These two deer up here are just awesome. The 16-point buck was his first really big buck. It was the first one to go on the wall, and it was big like George. And then there's the buck in velvet, which is Miss Annette's favorite. These two really represent George and Annette perfectly, the big and the small together, never separated, and always on the hunt together. And Miss Annette shared with me that she spent a lot of time in the deer stand with him and can track a deer just as good as anybody. So, but I really do love this picture, the big and the small together. And that's what I remember the most. I remember the most of seeing these two amazing folks love each other, love the Lord, and live their love for the Lord for all to see side by side. And all of these things represent the things that George loved to do that are up here. But what pales in comparison to how he loved these things is how he loves his wife. How he loves his girls, Julie and Katie, and his granddaughters, and all of his family, and how he loved his church. So what is it that set George Conn apart? What was it that made him such an incredibly great guy? is that he surrendered his life to Jesus, and he lived it in such a way that has truly made an impact on all of us. You heard that song, "As the Deer Pants for the Water, So My Soul Pants After You." It's from Psalm 42. I want to share with you a little bit of that, and then we're going to look at another passage of Scripture. Psalm 42 says this, "As the deer pants," or "as the deer longs for flowing streams, so my soul will long for you, God." Verse 2 says this, I thirst for God, the living God, and when can I come and appear before God?" In Psalm 42, there's two times where the psalmist says these words, and I think it's really interesting. "Why, my soul, are you so dejected? Why are you in so much turmoil?" He asks two questions, and then there's a resounding statement. It says this, "Put your hope in God, for I will still praise him, my Savior and my God." In the midst of the troubles of life, what the psalmist knew is exactly what George Conn knew, was that our hope doesn't come from the world. But if we will fix our heart and our lives on Jesus, on God, we'll have everything we ever need. And if we focus on those things, we have everything we need. But if we focus on the world around us, we might miss the bigger, more important things, the eternal things. So George knew to place his hope and trust in God. George truly is a blessed man and was such a blessing to so many. To know George and Annette is not only to love them, but to be loved by them. And as we look around, we can see how this gentle giant has really impacted so many lives. And I believe that this crowd just scratches the surface, if we're all going to be honest. George was an important guy down our preschool hall, as in every aspect of our ministry here. But George was important because he was called on to depict just how big Goliath is. Right? I want to tell you another sweet thing from the preschool hall that I heard. Our kiddos wouldn't just measure how big something was because if it was big, it had to be big like Mr. George, but there was something else they associated with him. That if someone was nice and if they were kind, they would ask, "Are they as nice and as kind as Mr. George?" What an impact. And as you look around the room, there's families here with young ones because he continued to have an impact because he lived his life leveraged for a greater purpose than we can imagine. And it really comes out of 1 Timothy 4. And I'm gonna take this verse and we're going to look at it maybe in a different way today. It says this, "Command and teach these things. Don't let anyone look down on you or despise your youth, but set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity." This verse here, Paul is talking to Timothy about, don't let anyone look down on you for your youthfulness. Well, what I would like to share with you today is George Conn didn't let any age bother him when it came to sharing his love for Christ in an example. He was so giving. No matter what your age was, whether you were maybe a more mature adult or a preschooler, he was going to set the example for how to live a life of love for Jesus. It goes on to say in verses 15 and 16, "Practice these things, be committed to them, so that your progress may be evident to all. Pay close attention to your life and your teaching. Persevere in these things, for doing this you will save both yourself and your hearers." George knew that and he lived it. It wasn't just something he said. It was exactly how he lived his life, and he knew that by living his life according to the Scripture, even if you didn't believe the Scripture, you were going to get it by the way he lived, and that it was going to bring you to a moment where you had to answer the question about Christ yourself. The life of Mr. Conn is just like this in the Scripture, and there's three things I want to point out to you about that. How can we live a life of purpose? How can we live a life of impact? Like Mr. George, first off, it's that character. The character of a man who is blessed is a man who makes his purpose in life to be a godly and a good man. See, it's not just enough to be good, you have to be godly. To live a purpose that is guided by principles. These principles that George lived by were those in Timothy. and many others, but they're in Timothy of love, faith, and purity. And really, you can go on into Galatians 5, 22 and 23, the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There should be a picture of George Conn next to that passage, because he lived that so well. These things are only produced at length in our lives when we have a personal relationship with Christ, so to have character. The second is to live your life with a significant conduct. The blessed man's secret begins in character formed by his relationship with Christ, and then it is lived out in such a way as to impact others around you. George's faith was not just talk. He lived it in his actions. He didn't just say what he thought. He lived what he believed all of the time. He showed us what it looked like to love God with your whole heart. He set the example for us all. And in the scripture there in Timothy, he says, set the example. Interesting thing about that word example in the Greek is the Greek word tupos, and it means to leave a mark or a blow. George Conn lived his life with constancy and consistency that left a mark on every single one of us. He left a tremendous impact by the way he lived his love for Christ, not just in word, but in action and in deed. His gentle kindness has left a tremendous impact. He conducted his life always willing to serve, and that leads us to the last piece. He lived his life with confidence, and that confidence led him to a conclusion. The blessed man's life has a happy conclusion with great confidence. And where did George find the ability to have that confidence? Well, a brief examination of his life would lead you to know that he and his family were truly blessed because they had a faith and a commitment to Christ Jesus that was real. It was authentic. And it put you in a place to say, how can I have that? The Bible says, Jesus said, whoever acknowledges me before men, I will also acknowledge him before my Father in heaven. But whoever does not acknowledge me before men, I will not acknowledge before my Father in heaven. George lived his love for Jesus out loud for all of us to see. And he had placed his trust in Jesus, as you already heard. He placed his trust in Christ at the age of 12 and was baptized at the Southwest Baptist Church in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. And he lived it from that day forward, serving as a deacon, serving in countless ways around the church, and serving down that preschool hall. Unmistakable commitment and untiring service are really the hallmarks of his ministry. Unconditional love is the love and life of Mr. George Conn, first for his Lord, for his family, and for all of us that are sitting here, our lives impacted by such a tremendous man of faith and a tremendous man of action. So what will it be for us? For us, how will we live out the legacy of this life lived so very well? There are some large crocks that are going to need to be filled in many aspects, not just in this church, but all around. And I'm telling you, all you got to do is take one look at this crowd and know the impact of his life. How will we live the legacy that Mr. George has left for us? Well, it starts here. It starts with peace that surpasses all understanding. Have you come to a place in your life where you understand what George understood and lived? That we will not have hope in this life until we fix our eyes on the cross of Calvary. That we are all fallen and in need of saving, and God demonstrated his love for us, and that while we were yet sinners, he sent Christ to die for us. And will you surrender your heart and life to Jesus, just like Mr. George did? I think the best way to honor Mr. George would be to do just that, to continue to live the same selfless servant lifestyle to Christ the King that he did, to live a life of unconditional generous love, to make faith and family and church priorities that have an impact that go beyond our own lives to touch countless lives around us. That's the legacy of Mr. George Conn. The impact that he's made in all of us. And now it's like the torch is being passed. Are you ready and willing to take up that torch? To say, I'm going to live my life with that same unconditional love as Mr. George did. But it starts at the cross of Calvary. Real quickly, heads bowed, eyes closed. In the quietness of this moment, a man who loved Jesus as much as George, he would want me to share the gospel. Having seen what he has seen and experienced what he's experienced, the biggest question he would have for you today is, what will you do with Jesus? Have you trusted Jesus as your personal Savior? The Bible says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. You can't be good enough to earn it, and we don't do anything to deserve God's love. He just loves us. But we need salvation because we have all sinned. And it says that God demonstrated his own love in this, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. When we surrender our life to Jesus, trust him as Savior, and live like he is Lord, the Bible says you can know that you're saved. And the way you do that is easy. You turn from yourself, you turn from your sin, and you trust in Jesus. Romans says this, that if you will believe in your, if you will confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. So today, if that's you, if you're ready to take up the torch and leave a legacy like Mr. George, I want to lead you in a simple prayer. It's not the words of this prayer that matter. It's not the order that they're in. But what matters is the condition of your heart before a holy God. And if you're ready to surrender your life to Jesus, you pray this prayer right where you are as I pray it from up front. And it goes like this. Dear God, I know I'm a sinner. I've done things I shouldn't do, and I haven't done some things I should do. And that means I've broken your holy law. But God, I know that you loved me so much. You sent Jesus to take my place, my sin, and my shame upon himself on that cross. That he shed his blood and he died so that I could be forgiven of my sins. And I believe with all of my heart, God, that you raised him from the dead on the third day. And that proves that Jesus is who he says he is and that he's done for me what he's promised to do. And that means that Jesus is Lord and I have redemption and salvation in him alone. God, thank you for loving me. Thank you for saving me. In Christ's name. Amen. If you prayed that prayer this morning or this afternoon for the first time, or maybe you prayed it again, but something happened in your heart, I want you to know that all of the angels in heaven rejoice over even one decision to follow Christ, but I can tell you there's another one that's rejoicing as well, and that's George Conn. Because as God welcomed George, he said, well done, good and faithful servant. Thank you. Pastor Mark.
In just a moment, I'm going to read the sweetest letter from Annette about George and the family. Before I read that, I would just thank Pastor JP for what a great message. You don't often hear at a funeral service a message about salvation, but it's been my recognition of large congregations like this, that there's always people sitting in a funeral service at a congregation like this who don't know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. And you know, the Bible is so plain. It says that without Jesus, you can't go to heaven. It doesn't matter how many times you've been baptized or what churches you go to or where your membership is. You just can't go to heaven without Jesus. I say that just to honor George, because George was my friend. I was his pastor. He and I have prayed together and witnessed together. Rejoiced when we saw people come to Jesus. If he could be here in this service, physically present with us right now, he'd probably be a little overwhelmed, because he was, as Pastor, you said, and others have said, a behind-the-scenes kind of guy. But I know that he would want to be sure that every person that came here today recognized the most important thing about him, and that was Jesus. Jesus. You know, guys, this whole world is falling apart, and every person has to know something's not right and something's wrong. You just have to know that. And the amazing thing about Jesus Christ is that no matter what has ever happened in your life, no matter what you've ever done, no matter where you've been, no matter how many times you've been there, no matter how many times you've done it, Jesus Christ will forgive you. In this room right now are lives that are broken and hurting, marriages that are struggling, families that are wondering how they're going to put pieces back together and what they'll do with the brokenness. I can testify to you what it means to fall and get back up. I can tell you about the amazing grace of Jesus Christ. And I would encourage you to listen and hold on to the words that Pastor JP just shared. Because just like that, you can ask Jesus to forgive you for your sins and to come into your life and be your Savior. And instantaneously, you pass from death into life. And you can know forever that you're going to heaven when you die. I say all that because this letter I'm about to read, this sweet, sweet letter that Annette wrote, can only be written because of Jesus. It doesn't come because they had some magic ingredient that, oh, you know, they just met the right person at the right time and it just worked. That's the stuff of fairy tales. The truth is, life is hard. It's difficult to put the pieces together and keep them together. It's only through Jesus that we can come here today and celebrate a story like this. That's the only reason. It's through Jesus. And if my friend George Conn was here to tell you anything today, if he could tell you anything, he would tell you that Jesus is real and it's the most important decision you could ever make in your life, and to not put it off even for a moment, but to follow Jesus. Let me read this precious letter to you. I appreciate it, Annette. Thank you to all of our family and friends for joining us in celebrating the life of George. Words cannot express our gratitude for the love and sympathies our family has received. It's fitting we should be here between Thanksgiving and Christmas, thankful for the time we knew George and celebrating the birth of Jesus, the one who gives eternal life. George and I had a love story like no other, because it's ours. We were in the same second grade class. Never had another class again until senior English. George went to my church, but I didn't really know him. I invited him to the youth group, and we became friends. We went to the senior prom together as friends, and that night, George told me he was going to marry me. I told him he was crazy, And I told him to get lost. We were not ready for each other. God had a plan and brought us back together 3 years later. In 1973, we married and asked God to bless our marriage. We moved from Fort Lauderdale to Eustis, started the adventure of our lives. For 48 years, we worked together on the plan, and what an adventure it was. In 1974, George got his job with Florida Power and Light. For 44 years, he worked to support his family and many needs others had, as George. A lot of crazy things happened at the plant. You guys and Dale know what I'm talking about. The friendships George built and lives he touched were so important to him. He loved you guys and Dale. George loved his two girls. He was proud of you both. Did you always see eye to eye? No. His impact on your lives have made you what you are today. Your caring ways, work ethic, sense of adventure are part of him, and you always carry him with you. Dad worked hard for you to have what you needed most and the security of his love. Did he wish he had boys? No. The two of you filled every space in his heart. You camped, shot guns, fished, rode four-wheelers, butchered hogs, changed out a transmission, and the list goes on. Finley you were the twinkle in Grandpa's eye. Special in every way. You love snakes. He loved that about you. As you become an amazing young lady, stand tall, hold your head high, just like Grandpa, and let the world see your beautiful blue eyes that he loved so much. George loved his church. He loved serving his Lord here. His list would be long, but George was a behind-the-scene kind of guy. People who do things that count never stop to count them. I should read that statement again. People who do things that count never stop to count them. George did them for the Lord. George loved working in the preschool wing. He was the bouncer. He kept the kids in line and bounced them on his knee, showing God's love. George was the live jungle gym. George loved music. Singing was one of his ways he worshiped God. He loved being part of the choir. George loved to hunt and fish. He called it his bonus time with God. With friends or alone, in the woods or on the water, George felt close to God when he was in nature. God sent Jesus as a baby to save us from our sins. Trusting him will give us eternal life. George trusted Jesus with his life, his marriage, his children, his everyday walk. Did George always do everything right? No, but that's the joy of knowing Jesus. He forgives us. And we have eternal life. So here we are, between Thanksgiving and Christmas, thankful we knew George and celebrating his eternal life because he trusted Jesus. George and I had a love story like no other because it was ours. We had a good marriage. We trusted God for the plan he had for us. It was with sadness I received the news, but I knew that George was with Jesus. There's a plaque on the wall between the big deer and the small deer. It reads, "Hunting season closed." George's hunting season is closed. And he heard his Savior say, "Well done. Well done."
What will it be like when my pain is gone and all the worries of this world just fade away? What will it be like when you call my name in that moment when I see you face to face? Waiting my whole life to hear you say, "Well done, well done, my good and faithful one. Welcome to the place where you belong. Well done, well done, my beloved child. You have run the race. Now you're home. Welcome to the place where you belong. What will it be like when tears are washed away and every broken thing will finally be made whole? What will it be like when I come into your glory, standing in the presence of a love so beautiful? I'm waiting my whole life for that day. I will live my life to hear you say, will it be like when I hear that sound, all of heaven's angels crying out, singing, "Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord." Singing, "Holy, my good and faithful one.
we come together in these next moments to gather around the table and to share a meal together and to share stories and to encourage and to love on one another and to love on this family. And so we want to invite you, if you're able to stay in these next few moments, we're going to ask the family. I'm going to ask Pastor JP and his wife Emily if they would help escort the family over to our dining room. And then we're going to invite you to come and join us together. I hear there's lots of stuff to eat and a great time for us to come together and celebrate in this time. And so would you guys stand all together? Miss Jeanette asked me to sing that song at the end, and I have heard it before, but as I started to listen to it and I thought about George, in my office at the piano just wept. And I thought, Lord, there ain't no way I'm going to get through that song. But you know, it's because of George. It's because of his love for Jesus and the life that he lived. And so I'm grateful that because of that, God allowed me to sing that without losing it. I'm sure I will. So, but we're, again, just so very, very grateful to have had so many people here today in honor of George. And again, we invite you to come and stay with us. So let's pray together. Father, we love you. We thank you so much for this time that we've had to celebrate George Conn, a life lived well, and God, a legacy shown and expressed right here in this room by the hundreds of people that are here. And so we thank you, God, for this time that we've had. Help us, Lord, to live our lives like George did, sold out for you, humbled, God, and ready to lend a helping hand whenever needed. Bless the food that we're going to have and the time of fellowship around the table. And Father, just again, through your perfect way, your Spirit, impress upon our hearts, God, those moments to reach out and to call and to just let them know that we're thinking about them. Thank you again, for we pray this in your name. Amen. You're dismissed. Thank you for being here.
So long it ends.
Are you tired and troubled, weighed down by a heavy load? Praying for change, searching for faith, waiting on a miracle. Are you drowning in questions? Can't believe where the road has led. There's one who knows the heavy you hold, and he says, come to me, all who are weary and heavy burdened, all who are hurting. Come to me, I'll be your shelter. My yoke is easy, my load is light, and you can find rest for your soul. Rest for your soul.
Who am I that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt? Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Well, not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling. That calmed the sea.